Happy Easter and welcome to Pleasant Grove Community Church. I'm Phil Somerville, one of the pastors here, and I want to start out with an ancient traditional greeting where I will say, "He is risen," and you'll respond, "He is risen indeed." I want you to say it out loud. Say it to your spouse or to your family, to your screen. Most of all, say it to God and say it with enthusiasm. Are you ready? He is risen. That was great. At least I'm going to believe it was great because I believe in you. Well, we want to welcome you to our Easter service. Whether you're watching us from your living room, from your bedroom, from the kitchen, whether you're in California or somewhere else in the United States or across the planet, we welcome you. And if you're someone who is watching because a friend of yours or a family member sent you a link, thank you for clicking on it and joining us in our Easter celebration. And if you want to know more about our church, if you have questions about Jesus, about Christianity, about what you hear in this video, please contact us. If you just need to talk to someone, email us or call us, and we'll get back to you. The contact information is at the end of this video. We're going to sing together. We are going to be lifted up with wonderful music. We are going to hear from our kids. We are going to be inspired by a powerful message because hope is alive. And when we sing, I want to encourage you to sing out loud. Lift up your voice and worship God. And then listen. Listen for God to speak to you. Now, as we begin, let's once again, with enthusiasm, He is risen. He is risen indeed. Let us worship.
See, crown Him with many crowns.
Crown Him with many crowns. The Lamb upon His throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns all music but its own. Awake, my soul, and sing of Him who died for thee. Faithfulness, none can deny. Through the the storm and through the fire. There is truth that sets me free. Jesus Christ, who lives in me.
You are stronger.
You are stronger. You are stronger. Sin is broken. You have saved me. It is written. Christ is risen. Jesus, you are Lord of all.
No beginning.
Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as
Hi, we're Joe and Sarah Caples. We've been hanging around PGCC since January, and Pastor Scott asked us to share a little bit of our story with you today.
And as you'll hear, we are very different. We're complete opposites. Our faith backgrounds and our approach to our relationship with God is quite different.
Yeah, I didn't grow up going to church or really even having spiritual conversations as a kid. But in high school, I started going to youth group, and when I was a senior, I decided to get baptized. So then when I came time for college, I decided to go to Bible college. And I studied hard and I worked really hard, ended up graduating with honors. But pretty soon after I graduated from college, I started to fall away from my faith. I started to really question the things that I'd been learning for years and all the things I spent so much time studying and working on. It wasn't really connecting. I had all this head knowledge and I understood all the facts of the Bible, but it wasn't really in my heart. I didn't have a strong relationship with God to where, and when I had struggles, I would lean on my own abilities and understanding rather than turning to God for help. And so at that time, God really just allowed me to wander a little bit and let me kind of just go on my own to see how that would turn out.
And for me, I grew up in a Christian home. My parents had my sister and I baptized when we were little girls. And I don't really remember a time where I didn't know about Jesus and God and didn't have a relationship with him. It was just something that was part of our lives growing up. And for me, I'm more of a sensing, feeling type of person. And so leaning into a personal relationship with God has always been something that was really easy for me. I always had a sense of the Spirit and sense of God. And it was really easy for me to turn to him and just everyday things in prayer and in reading the Bible and just journaling and being able to see God at work and all the everyday experiences of life. But Joe, on the other hand, came from a very different approach of, he's very systematic and very analytical and very logical, and things have to line up in a certain way. And so our approach to dealing with different struggles and hard times is quite different.
Yeah, so it was really good that God kept us together, even through hard times in the beginning of our marriage, because he really ended up using Sarah to bring me back to him during this crisis of faith I was having. We decided to start reading the Bible together and having conversations about it. And as we did that, it wasn't that the stories we read were new. They were all stories I'd read a handful of times before and had studied. But as we read them together and Sarah was able to share her perspective and we talked through, God really started to show me a new way to view his word and to view my relationship with him. And as we talked, the things that were all in my head, this head knowledge I had built up, started to really move to my heart. And I started to rely on God more as things would come up. And really, this made our relationship better, and it made my relationship with God a lot better.
Yeah, and because I grew up in the church and because I always had a very strong faith, it's always been easy for me to rely on God. And I didn't have a story like Joe or like other people who went from I didn't have faith to a transformation moment of I did, or even so much of I had this knowledge and all of a sudden there was this moment or this experience that made it click for me. And for me, it wasn't that. And I think a lot of us have those stories of it was a progression. It was a series of just everyday moments and everyday joys and struggles that built our relationship and dependency on God. And just because I grew up in the church and always had a strong faith doesn't mean that there weren't struggles and hard times, because none of us are immune to that. For example, I struggled with self-worth as a teen and a young adult. We struggled in our marriage, and when Joe was going through his crisis of faith and struggling with his relationship with God, I mean, I questioned and wondered, like, did we get married too young? Are we gonna make it through this? To financial issues as a young married couple too, and during the recession, Joe being put on the layoff list and wondering if we're gonna be able to pay our bills. To I had a strained relationship with my mom for several years. To as simple as being a stay-at-home mom to 3 boys, 3 and under, and wondering if I can keep my sanity together till the end of the day. And I think it's common that we just have these everyday things, but because of my relationship and my dependency with God, I would lean into Him in these times of struggle, in these times of questioning. I would pray and I would journal, and there are times where God would answer my prayers immediately. For example, Joe's name got off the layoff list and we would get side jobs that would be the exact amount that we needed to pay our bills. To other times, He didn't answer our prayers immediately, and it was, you know, it wasn't until I looked back or read my journals to see what God was doing in that work. Like bringing my relationship with my mom, He brought different people into our lives, and I went through counseling to a point where now our relationship is restored and it's better than it was before. So God uses all of these different things to build our relationship with Him, to strengthen our dependency on Him, that when times of struggle do come up now, my first approach isn't to say, God, why is this happening? What's going on? I now kind of laugh and then say, huh, I wonder what God is doing in this. And a lot of times He's using these stories too to build our compassion and our empathy that we can relate and help other people through similar struggles.
Yeah, because we all have different stories and different ways that we approach God and approach things that go on in our lives. And God uses that. He uses our differences to really help build each other in our relationship with Him and as we go through things in life. He does that on purpose.
Seems like all I-
Cody. I'm the Minister to Women in Office Administrator here at Pleasant Grove Community Church, and I'm going to be leading us through the family prayer time. Before we start, I did want to point out that our missionary this month is the Union Gospel Mission in Sacramento. They serve the greater Sacramento area. Pastor Tim Lane is the man that God has appointed to be there, and they serve the homeless with food, clothing, and shelter. Now, during this COVID-19 period of time, they have modified their programs a bit, but they're still serving in a variety of ways with brown bag dinners, men's clothing and showers, and food boxes for families and seniors, which are still being distributed. So as we go to prayer, let's be sure to keep them in mind as well. Let's just quiet our hearts before the Lord, and then I will lead us in prayer. Father God, we come to you on this Easter Sunday and we celebrate the risen Savior, your wonderful Son, who rose to give us that free gift of salvation, Father. We just thank you for this beautiful day and for this opportunity that we have to celebrate. Even though we're not together, we can still celebrate in spirit, and I thank you for that, Lord. You are a gracious, kind, good, and loving God, and we thank you for that. Father, we do pray right now for the Union Gospel Mission. We just ask that you would bless that ministry. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to minister to them and to help support them. We ask that you just give Pastor Tim a wisdom as they continue to serve the homeless in the greater Sacramento area during this very unusual time. Father, we just ask that people will be blessed and that they will come to you as a result of the Union Gospel Mission's ministry there. Father, we thank you for blessing our church family during this period of time when we are apart. We just continue to look to you for health for all of our members and regular attenders, as well as their extended families. And we praise you that, to the best of our knowledge, nobody has tested positive for the COVID-19 virus. We praise you for that, Lord. Even extended families have been spared, and we thank you for that. We thank you for meeting our needs during this time, Father, whether they're physical needs, emotional needs, or spiritual needs. Lord, we know that you care about each of those because you care about us, and we thank you for that, Lord. We thank you for loving us. We also thank you for all of those here at the church that have stepped up to help their neighbor. We thank you for those that are delivering groceries and those that are delivering medications and other needs of our people. We just ask for a special blessing on them, and we thank you that they are serving you as well as serving others, Father. And for our community and state and the world at large, Father, we thank you for the health in our community. We thank you for our healthcare workers, emergency responders, those at the grocery store who are stocking shelves and checking people out, all of those who continue to serve us during this awkward time, Father. We thank you for their courage and for their help and for their commitment to continue to be there for us. We ask that you continue to strengthen our bonds with our neighbors, Lord, as we reach out to them to make sure that they are doing okay. Even if they don't know you, Father, we trust that through our modeling your love for them, that they will come to know you. We're grateful to be in California, Father, where that curve has been flattened as a result of the measures that have been put in place. We, even though it's difficult to maintain that social distance and not be able to come together to worship, we thank you that our actions are actually helping, Father, and that this disease will be overcome. We thank you too, Father, for blessing the people in the hard-hit areas here in the country, in New York and New Orleans and Chicago. We just ask, Father, that you would bless those states and that you would be with the health care workers who are working tirelessly, Father, to help those that are in need. We also pray for all of those who have lost loved ones as a result of this awful disease. Just be with them, Father, encourage them and keep them, comfort them, Father. We also pray for the countries abroad, Lord, who are struggling with the disease, Great Britain and Italy and Spain and France and others, Lord. We just ask that you would be there, that you would strengthen their health care workers and emergency responders as well, and that you would give them the wisdom to know how to get ahead of this silent monster that we've been referring to. Father, we thank you for your grace and your mercy. And once again, more than anything else, we thank you that we can celebrate today a risen Savior, a risen Lord. We love you. And we pray the prayer together that Jesus taught the disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now, typically in our service, I would ask the ushers to come forward at this time for the morning offering. And we deeply appreciate each and every one of you that has been sending in your offerings or going online to make sure that those offerings get to the church. They really have helped out tremendously. We're able to maintain our building and pay salaries, and we just thank you from the bottom of our hearts. If you're still wondering how to give, please do one of the next two things. You can either mail your offering in to the church office at 1730 Pleasant Grove Boulevard, Roseville, 95747. Or to give online, go to our website, www.pgcc.church. Click on the top right-hand tab called Communicate, and then select Online Giving and follow the prompts. Again, thank you for supporting the ministries here at Pleasant Grove Community Church.
Thank you. Caples.
I'm Judah Caples.
I'm Kale Caples.
Happy Easter!
Happy Easter, PGCC!
Venus here.
Hi, PGCC!
I'm Clara.
And I'm Harrison. We miss you.
We hope you're safe and healthy.
Just before sunrise, on the third day, God sent an earthquake and an angel from heaven. When the guards saw the angel, they fell down with fright. The angel rolled the huge stone away, sat on top of it, and waited. At the first glimmer of dawn, Mary Magdalene and other women headed to the tomb to wash Jesus' body. The early morning sun slanted through the ancient olive gardens, dropped a dough glittering on leaves and grass. Little tears everywhere. The friends walked quietly along the hilly path through the olive groves until they reached the tomb, and immediately noticed something odd. It was wide open. They peered through the opening into the dark tomb, but wait, Jesus' body was gone.
And something else, a shining man was there with clothes made from lightning. "Don't be scared," the angel said, but they couldn't help it. They screamed anyway. The angel asked them, "What are you doing here?" "This is a tomb, and tombs are for dead people." The woman couldn't speak. "Jesus isn't dead anymore," he said. "He's alive again, and their heart leaps and such." Then the angel laughed with such gladness that they felt for a moment as if they had woken from a nightmare.
The other woman rushed home, but Mary stayed behind. How could it be true? Jesus was definitely dead. How could he be alive? Just then, Mary heard someone else in the garden. "Perhaps it's the gardener," she thought. "He'll know where Jesus' body is." "I don't know where Jesus is," Mary said urgently. "I can't find him." But it was all right. Jesus knew where she was and had found her. Mary, only one person said her name like that. She could hear her heart thumping. She turned around. She could just make out a figure. She shaded her eyes to see, and thought she was dreaming. But she wasn't dreaming. She was seeing Jesus. Mary fell to the ground, Sudden tears filled her eyes, and great sobs shook her whole body. And all she wanted in that moment was to cling to Jesus and never let him go. "You'll be able to hold on to me later, Mary," Jesus said gently, "and always be close to me. But now go and tell others that I'm alive."
"Hi, I'm Anna. This is my sister Catherine."
Mary ran and ran all the way to the city. She had never run so far in her life. She felt as if she could run forever. She didn't even feel like her feet were touching the ground. The sun seemed to be dancing and gleaming and bounding across the sky, racing with her and shining brighter than she could ever remember in the clear, fresh air. And it seemed to her that morning as she ran, almost as if the whole world had been made anew, almost as if the whole world was singing for joy. The trees, tiny sounds in the grass, the birds, her heart. Was God really making everything sad come untrue? Was he making even death come untrue? She couldn't wait to tell Jesus' friends. "They won't believe it," she laughed. She was right, of course.
Jesus' friends were afraid, so they were hiding in an upstairs room with the door bolted shut. But that didn't stop Jesus. He just walked straight through the wall. "It's a ghost," Thomas screamed and hid under the table. But it wasn't a ghost. "I'm hungry," Jesus said. "What's for lunch?" Peter gave him a fish. They all hung back and watched him eat it. "This can't be," they told themselves. "It's impossible. It's not happening." But it was, right in front of them. "Delicious," Jesus wiped his mouth with the back of his hand and grinned. "Can a ghost do that?" he winked, and they all laughed. "I'm really here," Jesus said, and he really was. Jesus said, "I am the Savior and the rescuer of the world," and they knew because he couldn't stay dead. And Jesus had come alive again, that somehow everything would be all right.
A few days later, as they walked together, Jesus told his friends, "It's time for me to go home to my Father." They all looked worried, and they remembered what Jesus had told them before he died. "There's a place for you. I'll get it ready," Jesus had said. "You know the way." Thomas had panicked. "I don't know the way to get there." "Yes, you do," Jesus had said. "I am the way and the truth and the life." When at last they reached the top of the highest hill near Jerusalem, Jesus turned to them and said, "Go everywhere and tell everyone the happy news. Tell them I love them so much that I died for them. It's the truth that overcomes the terrible lie. God loves his children. Yes, he really does." Suddenly, the whole sky was filled with a dazzling light. "Now everyone can come home to God," Jesus said. "Death is not the end of you. You can live forever with your Father in heaven because I have rescued the whole world."
Well, happy Easter, everyone. Easter 2020, April 12th, one that we probably will never, ever forget. In fact, it will hopefully resonate in our hearts and minds throughout our lives as a special, unique time, and hopefully one that we're reminded of the real meaning and the central themes of Easter. Just as we remember the very first Easter, and as we look at what was written in Scripture about that incredible event, each of the gospel writers includes the resurrection of Jesus. And we don't want to miss that again today. So wherever you are, wherever you're viewing from, just be centered in on remembering why we're here, why we celebrate this incredible event of the rising of Jesus from the dead, and to conquer death for all of us. Some years ago, I was working with a church in the Arizona area, and part of the church's tradition was to rent out a large portion of a huge park in the Phoenix area. And what they did is they would rent out this section of the park, and they would do their Easter service there. And they had an open area on the grass where they
cordoned off a large area where they would do an Easter egg hunt for kids and families. And then next to that, they had like a huge area where they had tables upon tables upon tables spread out with a gigantic feast. They had juices and coffee, and they had sweet rolls and rolls and breads, and they had all kinds of wonderful pastries. They had egg dishes and desserts and fruit and everything. I mean, it was this huge feast, this huge spread. And then right next to that, between where the Easter egg hunt took place on the lawns, and then this huge feasting area that was free to everyone who came. And then there was kind of an outdoor amphitheater. And underneath this huge, like, roof structure, they brought in staging and chairs and the sound equipment and everything to have their Easter service there. And the idea was that everyone would come and that they could do this stuff with kids and get all the eggs and have all that stuff and then have the feast at the same time. And then after that, they'd come into the service, and they set up probably, 800-plus chairs in this outdoor amphitheater. And it was a wonderful event, and they did it year after year. And really, the year that I was there, it was probably close to 2,000 people that showed up to do the Easter egg hunt and be with families. And they would send kids out in kind of sort of age levels. The youngest kids first would go out into this cordoned-off area. It's full of all kinds of eggs. And then after about 10 or 15 minutes, those kids would come off, and their baskets would be just heaping full of eggs. I mean, it was really fun. And to see the joy in their faces and the fun that all the families had. Then the next age group up would go out. They'd reseed kind of that whole area with more plastic eggs and candy inside of them. And more kids would do that. And then after their time was over, then they would take a break and get ready for the next age group up. And then they would again put more eggs out. So it was this amazing, amazing time. People were having a great time eating food, talking, hanging out, watching their kids get eggs, baskets full of eggs. And then it came time for the service. And probably what happened is they probably had about, maybe 600 people would stay for the service. There were special things for kids to do as well during the service. But what struck me was how many people came to the feast and came to the egg part with the egg hunt for all their kids and enjoyed their family time and meeting a few people, but then they would wander off and wander out. And I thought, wow, they've really missed Easter. I mean, for them, Easter was like coming to the park and feasting at the eggs and getting the eggs and all that, but then they missed the part of the celebration of the risen Christ by being a part of the service. And I thought, wow, we can miss Easter so much. And we don't want to do that. We don't want to just like miss the central theme of what Easter is all about. When the stories are recorded in the gospel, each of those four gospels records all of the events leading up to that holy week, that week before Easter, and then the resurrection of Christ. And what happens as he appears after the resurrection to those people around him, the disciples and others. And it's so important for us to get that when Jesus is recorded about the resurrection of his life, not only do the Gospels include that, but then the book of Acts talks about the early church and its response to the risen Jesus. And each and every one of the letters that's included in the book of Revelation, they all speak, all of them focus at the very heart of the resurrected living Lord Jesus Christ. That's what the Bible is about. That is what is saturated in the New Testament. On every single page, that is what the dynamic is behind everything that's written there, is that Jesus is alive. Jesus is risen, and that we now can have the salvation of God applied to our life. We can become new people in him. We can become Easter people. I love that. Think about it. But what keeps us from missing that so often? Sometimes we miss that. People miss Easter for a variety of reasons. If we look at the disciples alone, let's just focus on a couple of them. But first of all, Judas entirely missed Easter. Judas was one of the followers of Jesus. He'd been with him for 3+ years. He'd listened to everything that Jesus taught. He'd watched Jesus do miracles. He was right with him at many of those different events. He listened. He learned. He was with those other disciples in the process of growth and understanding. And yet something went off track for Judas. somewhere along the line, Judas missed out. He didn't get what was going on with Jesus. Somehow he became disillusioned or disappointed in Jesus. And people can do that. Maybe in your own life you've become disillusioned along the way with God. Maybe you were hoping that God would answer some prayer, or that he would show up and give you a new opportunity or guide you in a certain direction, and it didn't happen in your timing or in the way that you thought, and you became disillusioned with God. And that happens to people. And when that happens, oftentimes people will turn away from God and they'll say things like, well, that's just not for me. That's for other people. We can become disillusioned, and in that way we can move ourselves away from God and we can miss Easter. I read this about a 5-year-old Brian who was had a key part in the Easter production at the church. And his part was relatively easy, but at 5 years old, he couldn't always remember his part. But it came from just his reciting of Luke 4, 24, verse 6. He is not here, he is risen. But he got confused that he couldn't remember, and the director leaned over and whispered his part into his ear. And Brian confidently grabbed the mic and said, he is not here, he's in prison. Wow. We can miss Easter, and we can miss out on, like, what Easter is all about. Judas definitely missed Easter. But the other disciples came just so close. They were set up to miss Easter. And even after the resurrection, the disciples weren't exactly sure what had taken place. John, the gospel writer, writes this. He records this about that Easter time. He says, on the evening of the first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. And after he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. And the disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. The room was locked for fear of the Jewish leaders. Fear is so prominent a factor in what's going on with those early disciples that first Easter time. Fear has their attention. They're concerned about keeping the doors locked for fear of those outside that would try to get in, whatever their fears were. And yet Jesus comes and stands among them. Jesus stands among them. What would they be thinking when Jesus shows up in their room and shows them his hands and his side, the scars from his crucifixion? They're overjoyed. Can you imagine what they must have felt like when they had doubts and fears, and yet Jesus stands right there with them? The shock, the awe of that, and Jesus is alive and with them. For those disciples, the days before Easter were the very darkest, weren't they? They'd gotten gut punched. All of their stocks in their hope for the future crashed with Jesus' crucifixion. Emptiness reigned. Fear settled in and was getting a stranglehold on their lives. The future didn't seem to have the faintest hope for them. And there was no light at the end of the tunnel. In fact, a large stone stood as a reminder over that grave to seal it, cold and dank. Yet Jesus comes. Jesus comes and stands and steps into their arena. He's the one that brings calm to them. Who wouldn't want that? Who wouldn't want God to step into a life that is full of fears and anxiety? Who wouldn't want God to show himself, to reveal himself, to be close, to be right there when we need him? Who wouldn't want that? Yet sometimes we get so wrapped up in our fears that we miss God. We don't see his presence. We don't sense his presence. We don't hear him speaking. We haven't found him to be the one that brings calm because we're so focused on holding on to our fears, the things that seem to bind us away and grab for our attention. Even in the best of times, our fears can overtake us. We think about right now, even today, fears all around us. How do we deal with that? How do we deal with that? When we rest in Christ is when we place our fears back into his hands. When we're confident in our relationship with God and in Christ Jesus, We hand away our fears and give them to someone who can actually handle them. And that is the hope of God, isn't it? That's our hope, is to be able to be released of those challenges, released of those fears, and let God handle fear for us and to be strong with us in those times. I love what Jesus said. Jesus said this in John 16:33. I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world. Jesus is the one who overcomes our fears. For some of the disciples, there were doubts and there was skepticism. And they hid themselves behind those things. Those become great barriers for us as well, for many. Our doubts and skepticism. They were also locked in that room. Thomas was just that person. One of the disciples also who followed closely to Jesus. But Thomas had his doubts. John records this about Thomas. Now Thomas, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. He missed Jesus' first entry with them. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But Thomas said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my fingers where the nails were and put my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, and Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." And Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." I love Thomas because he's right out front with his doubts and his thoughts. Unless he sees and unless he touches Jesus, he doesn't want to believe. What about our doubts, our uncertainties? What about our concerns that way? Lee Strobel, in one of his books called The Case for Faith, when he's speaking about his own personal journey from atheism, wrote this: "To be honest, I didn't want to believe that Christianity could radically transform someone's character and values. It was much easier to raise doubts and manufacture outrageous objections than to consider the possibility that God actually could trigger a revolutionary turnaround in such a depraved and degenerate life." Wow. Wow. A little bit later in one of his other books, he said this: "If I had stopped asking questions, that's where I would have remained." It's okay to doubt. It's okay to have questions. I think that's great for us. Doubts, though, can overwhelm us and keep us so closed off to where we, like the disciples, are holding the door of our doubts closed. We need an opportunity to open ourselves up, something that will change us to openness of possibility. Thomas turns and acknowledges Jesus as Lord. He opens up the possibility. He opens up the door to discovery. So the question is your door shut so tightly that you're not even open to the possibilities with your doubts and skepticism? My hope is that we're not bound by and captive by our doubts. Jesus didn't let Thomas off the hook. Jesus presented himself to Thomas with open hands and open wounds. The question for us is, will we be open to the possibilities of Christ revealing himself to us? It may not be the way that Jesus reveals himself to Thomas. Obviously not. But every time a person moves to seek God and to seek Christ, God shows up. God is right there. He desires that from all of us. Did you notice what side of the door Jesus showed up on? He was on the inside. He was on their side. He's on our side. He stands close to us. He brings his presence to life in us. The resurrected Jesus always stands close to us. He brings his presence, his hope, his joy, and his peace to overwhelm all of those things around us that would push us away from experiencing what Easter really is. Because Easter is what? It is the resurrected, living Lord Jesus who brings salvation to all of us when we trust in Him. Today, that's my greatest hope for us in April 12th, 2020. That we would be people who know with confidence that we can place our hope into the living Christ. That He hasn't given up on any of us, but that He loves all of us and desires to draw us to Himself. That we would find hope and peace. That we would find confidence over our doubts. That our worries and anxieties and fears would drift away when we hand those things over to Him and allow Him to be the King and the reigning Lord, the living one. To miss Easter is to miss some very important things. If we were to miss Easter, I want to remind you of four things that we miss out on if we miss Easter. Number one is we miss out on the pardon from Christ. That Christ's death on the cross for us pardons us from our sins when we grasp that and claim it. Don't miss out on the pardon for your salvation in Christ. The second is, don't miss out on the peace of Christ. Each time Jesus entered the room where the disciples were, He said, "Peace be with you." He says that to you today if you're sitting alone in your home or if you're with family or friends. He says that to all of us today, "Peace be with you." Jesus would like nothing more than in all of the turbulence around for Him to be able to say in confidence, and you would know it, "Peace be to you." Here's the third thing don't miss out on. Don't miss out on the power of Christ. When Christ enters into a person's life, when we commit ourselves to Him, He brings the power of the Spirit of God into that person to help us to stand, to help us to give us a firm foundation, to give us the strength to be the people He's called us to be. Don't miss out on the power of God to live daily with Him. And fourth, don't miss out on paradise with Christ. That is the future hope for us in heaven, that when we give ourselves to Jesus, we have the hope of heaven out ahead of us. He gives us power today, but He gives us the hope of the future of tomorrow. Let's not miss out on Easter this Easter, April 12th, 2020. Don't miss it. Don't miss it. I know you won't. I'm just going to pray with us right now. If you want to just pray with me. Don't miss out on Easter. Don't let this day go by, this moment slip by you. I'm going to lead just a simple prayer of invitation to any of you who would like to call upon Jesus to come into their life right now today. This year, why wait? This is the day for you. Just follow me along in this very simple prayer. Jesus, I claim You as my Lord. I confess my sins to You. I invite You, the risen one, to come into my life, to totally transform me through Your power, and to cleanse me and make me the person You want me to be. I ask You, Jesus, today, would I be Your son or Your daughter? And through the power of Your Spirit, would You just indwell my life as I step in faith towards You? Jesus, I claim You as my Savior. I ask You to forgive my sins and to be my Lord. And today, April 12th, 2020, I commit myself to You today. For all of us today as we pray, Heavenly Father, bless each of us this Easter, that it would be remarkable to us, to remind us of the great person that You brought in Christ to forgive our sins and to lead us to salvation and relationship with You. Remind us of the joy and hope we have in You, that we serve a living God who loves us. We pray these things in Jesus' name, the risen one. Amen.
His hands, His feet.
for Christ the King.
Well, thank you for being with us this Easter Sunday. And we pray that just God will bless you and protect you and be with you. And really, as a benediction today, it's really a blessing that I want to just lay out to all of us today. That the mighty, powerful God that we love and serve would bring His hand upon us and bless each of us, protect us, and remind us that this Easter, we live in Him. We breathe in Him. We are His people. May we live in the joy of the risen Christ. Amen and amen.